Well, I'm going here to tell you the third part of the story, which is actually a very sad part up to this point. And I'll show you and I'll explain to you, because I consulted for the people who built the Mose barriers from 1995 through 2013, when there was the bigger explosion of the Mose scandal. And we were a group of MIT professors. Our chair was Professor Rafael Braz, the former department head of civil environmental engineering, and he's now the provost and CEO of Georgia Tech, Professor Andrew Whittle. So we started, and this is a fantastic depiction, which I want to show, because the concept of the Mose as these movable gates which lie on the bottom of the inlets and come up only when there is the prediction of a high water and protect and divide the lagoon from the sea, actually is an idea which went back to 1972. In 1972, I had just started working that beautiful building, when we had what was called Consorzio d'Idee, that is a group of people from the different countries which were suffering from storm surges, and they came to Venice. And there was a collection of ideas and discussions. There were the British, because London was totally flooded by the storm surge of the North Sea, totally in analogy to the Adriatic Sea. There were all the people from the Netherlands. The Netherlands are below water and they are surrounded by Moses. And this was a pictorial revision of what could be the barrier for Venice, that is lying on the floor, and then when there is the high water coming, they raise it up, which is actually is almost Kafkaesque, because it is really gives what the barriers are now. So this was made the conceptual model by a famous oceanographer. Walter Monk was called by, who was one of my mentors, was turned 100 last October 19th. He was called the Einstein of the Ocean by the New York Times. He and his wife were there, they were Venice lovers, they spent a sabbatical year. Their painter, so to speak, made this sketch, this conceptual model of the Venice barrier. Walter Monk, he's the god of oceanography. Philippe's Institute of Oceanography, by the way. Okay, when the project was started, the discussions were started, there was an incredible number of limitations imposed on the construction of the project itself. Remember, the Venice and the Lagoon are UNESCO sites. They are protected by the European laws of the UNESCO sites, and also in Venice we have a very severe Office of Arts, for which things which disturb the beauty and the landscape are forbidden. Now, if you come to Venice, you cannot make a new window in your apartment, because that destroys what was the ancient shape. So the restrictions imposed by the governments and the law were enormous. No structural changes allowed the lagoon inlets, which could affect the exchange between the lagoon and the water. Why? Venice has no sewage system. So Venice is flushed by the M2 tide. The tide of M2 implies that it goes back and forth every 12 hours. 12 hours a day, Venice is cleaned. So if you change the structure, in a sense restricting or enlarging, you change the flush of the tide. Flexibility, invisibility. This was a condition sine qua non. That is, without this, no project would carry. The barriers must be invisible when they are not in use. Otherwise, they deteriorate the landscape around. Requirement, and the barriers, this was the limitation given, because 110 centimeters is, the San Marco Square will be underwater, even with less than 110 centimeters. But other collateral works can be done to resolve the problem, adaptation and mitigation in certain parts. For the entire lagoon, these were the limitations. Now, I want to show you things which are in other parts of the world. Well, these are what I called the claws. The claws in the Rotterdam Harbor. They may be beautiful for the Rotterdam environment and landscape. Imagine of coming to the Lido of Venice, the Lido Inlet, even though you are not in a boat 6 stories high, in a small boat. You enter and you see this thing. And in the front, you have on the sides villages which are 300 years old with the small houses, red roofs, and in the back, in the front, you have the Ducal Palace. No way. Sorry. No way. Let me show you other monstrosities, as I call them. This is the Skelda, the Skelda barriers. Can you look at these things? There are other monsters. And in London, this is London, on the Thames. London was the storm surge I talked is the storm surge of the North Sea which floods London. These were constructed, completed in the early 80s, with a lifetime until 2030, which means in the moment, in 10 years they will be obsolete, even though they will not. These are most, can you imagine again in the Lido Inlet, you come or the other inlets, you have the lagoon, you have islands, Torcello is was built in 800. Well, these things cannot be built in Venice. There is a limitation to how much horror you can do to a city. So this was the proposal. I showed this plan because this was the proposal originally. I'm talking about this plan because I saw I was there. We discussed it. This was made in the still before, the world started in 2003. This was made a transition in 19. I don't go into details because the story of barriers in Venice would fill an entire lecture, which I have given. An artificial island was constructed because the Lido Inlet is too big. You cannot raise a barrier which is, it is impossible, technically and engineering impossible. So the barriers in Lido Inlet will be two, with one is the refuge harbor for the ships, and we showed the picture, the barrier to the northern part, that was the only one which was completed in 2014. And I'll tell you about the story, because unfortunately it's becoming to be a very sad story. The barriers may never be finished. This is the punchline, which is, if it happens, 5.5 billion euros, which is $6 billion will have been spent, because the last 200 millions have not yet been burst to finish the barriers. Now, construction, let me, you see these, the lines show the position where you put, you make the barriers. The barriers are constituted by the construction of cement caissons, caissons which go onto the bottom. And the caissons, on each caisson there will be situated a gate. And now this plot here shows you very, I think, very clearly. Okay, the red line counters the caisson which is positioned on the bottom of the inlet. This is from Malamocco, which is the biggest. Malamocco is 15 meters deep, and because of these sediments, all those sticks, all those poles below are to keep the sediments, the ground, stable. And there are other big poles to constrain the caisson from the sides. The caissons are built somewhere else. They are brought by barges, and all the squares, 4, 5, and so forth, when they float, they are empty. Because they must be brought on the location, empty, they must float. When they are location, all the 4s and 3s are filled up with water. So they are positioned with enormous precision, they sink down, 5 is a granulated sand, and you see the galleries, 6, which is redundant. You have 2 galleries which go from one side of the barrier to the other for maintenance, to control that the instrumentation is functioning, to control that what needs to be replaced, what needs to be repaired. What you see there in 2, those are the hinges. The hinges are constituted by 2 parts, a male and a female hinge. The female hinge is attached to the caisson on the bottom. The male is attached to one which is the gate. When the gate is, I'll show you a picture, is put in position, the male goes inside the female with a tolerance. I have seen one last June, put down, a tolerance of 1 centimeter as a side, and then the gate lies on the bottom. The gate lies on the bottom, it is full of water. The moment there is the prediction of the high water coming, then here is the system. Yes. A pressurized system pushes the water out, fills up the gate with air, the gate raises up and stands against the sea level rising. The gates have been constructed And this is fascinating because it is a very, it is buoyancy. It is the simplest physical principle. Nothing just push the water out, fill up with the air. The moment the situation, the sea level out goes back to the sea level in, you fill up with the water and they go down. So the project is fantastic. It is simple. It is a, the problem is that the project is in Italy. And Italy is well known for having the most Byzantine political system. We had our general elections the 4th of March, and the populists have won. Basically, the populist wave, which is invading over the world, the green, the five stars. It is a nightmare. Sorry, but I don't need to tell you what populism is in this moment in the United States. So this is just the principle of the Gates. This is Malamocco, and I want to show you because these are the castles before they were being put down. You see, they are enormous. To put them down, you need a budget. I have moves, but there is no time. This is the village of the workers, which is now empty because all the gates in Malamocco have been put down. What is lacking is the electric power plant, the power plant. So they're down, but you can't finish them up because there is not the electrical system. I'm serious. There is not the electrical system. Only one gate is complete with a power plant to come up. And I show you the village of the workers is almost empty. But to get some knowledge, know-how, in 20 years of projecting, preparing, making the plans for the Moses study in the province of Venice, an enormous amount of knowledge and technological skill has been accumulated. There is a know-how which can be communicated to students. And in fact, last summer, we had a summer school in collaboration between MIT and the University of Architecture in Venice. And we lived a summer camp, the Camp Pellescrina Camp. We had 10 MIT students and 8 from the University of Venice, and we lived. This is one of the gates of Malamocco. Look at this stuff. Enormous. We walk, and here is our group, MIT, Professor Andrew Vito, Civil Environmental Engineering. I am hidden there on the field left, in front of Professor Fregolent. We had a fantastic summer camp in which the students worked at engineering project, at urbanistic process regarding the island of Pellestrina. We are going to repeat the summer school the second, third week of this June. And we are working now to go back and do other projects. Just to communicate all the richness of knowledge, of technological skill, which has been accumulated in 20 years of work. And this, I think, is a heritage, a legacy of the Mose. This is the first and only North Lido. This was when it was tested. It was November 2014. Well, this has been functioning perfectly. In almost 4 years of construction, it has been raised 3 times, which means that by November of this year, it will have been under salty water for 4 years. You know what that means? Corrosion, degradation, malfunctioning. Why? Because in 2014, there was an enormous scandal which exploded because to proceed, unfortunately, in Italy, political corruption is endemic. To get things done, you pay the politicians. So the director of the consorzio, Venezia Nuova, everything was proceeding fine. He was paying the politicians on the left, on the right, on the top, on the north, the south, and the north. However, at a certain point, the scandal exploded. Since then, the work had stopped. The Malamocco gates were put all down last summer. We saw one. Chioggia is on the point of being finished, Lido South is not. The point is that the works have been completely stopped. There is nobody working at the village of the works since the end of 2015. Why? Because of the corruption, because investigators and inspectors were nominated, and because the last $2 million to conclude the works have not yet been given. So, 2 million and 5.5 billion euros have already been spent. $6 billion, but the last. So, if you don't have the money to construct the power plant, you cannot raise the gates. So, I'm serious, there is a danger. First, that the gates will never be completed. Or, that will be completed, but by now, the gate which was completed in 2014 has damages. After 4 years of salty water, submerged salty water, and the damages can be enormous because the salty water is corrosion. And I don't know, in this moment I'm very pessimistic because basically the works have stopped since the end of 2015. Now with the new election, nobody knows who will be the prime minister, who will be one of the five stars, God forbid. But unfortunately, they are the first party, they have won 32% of the votes. 32%. They cannot govern by themselves because the government needs 40% majority. So they must ally themselves. Most probably they will ally themselves with Berlusconi to come back. Believe me, that's when I talk Byzantine politics. So I had the honor of being invited to give the Rachel Carson lecture at the American Geophysical Union meeting in December of last year. Rachel Carson, I think you know, was a woman, an incredible woman, who brought to the attention of the public the enormous dangers which pesticides and chemicals can induce. She was really vilified by all the chemical industry. Thanks to her, the Environmental Protection Agency, and to her books, The Silent Spring, the dangers of DDT and the pesticides. So they made a lecture, she was a marine biologist. They made a lecture for people who work on something which can be of public utilities. I had worked all my life is linked to Venice, and I had the incredible honor of it. And I ended with this, I gave many more details, I ended with this slide. And you get it. The ancient Venetians created a civilization which lasted for 1,000 years. It was the most civilized, the freest country in all Europe. It had a Renaissance which was second to none. Because if you think about the Venetian Renaissance, only the paintings, let us say the three, Titian, Tintoretto, Veronese, and all the minors, Sansovino as the architect, Pietro Aretino, they came away from Rome. Venice was at the center of the culture, and the Venetians were free entrepreneurs, and it was the richest, and it was free. Independent, well, I do not know. I am very pessimistic. I am saying here this because that's how I ended. The gates may never be completed. The barriers may never be completed. And if they are, they will have, you know, in the original plan, the cleaning of one edge, each barrier, was every 5 years. Take out all the gates and put them down. Well, the first barrier was built in 2014, the 5 year cycle should start now. So I'm very pessimistic. I conclude with this because after years of working there and to see that the $6 billion are wasted because of the bureaucracy and the political ineptitude and paralysis is very sad. I'm Italian, but this is I'm Venetian actually. I'm more proud to be Venetian than Italian. This is a conclusion. Follow the news. I hope I'm a Cassandra, predicting disaster, but after all, Cassandra was correct.